welcome you all to the session. We are week 11, by the way. The session where we'll be going to the very exciting area of research. This course being ACE 811 for the master students and ACE 911 for the doctoral students. And there is Advanced Educational Research Methods and Statistics 1 and 2. The difference between the master's and the PhD is that they will do largely the same content, but will go deeper for the doctoral students. And the exams will also be different. Now, Monday, June the 15th, I hope you had a nice weekend. And our agenda for today looks like this. I'm giving a welcome now. I'm going to review the performance in week 10, after which we have a two-part lecture, which will be given by Dr. Emmanuel Olufemi Jayola. We start at 10, it's actually 10 now, and then by 10:40-45, we will break for question and answer session, and then we'll continue by 11, and by 12 noon, we'll have a short announcement, and then we will close. So let's look at the performance, your performance in week 10. I will now share my screen of the results, which had already been sent to you. We present the results to everybody. So for AC 811911, that's this course on advanced statistics, advanced research methods. These are for top scorers. So all of these people scored as we have listed here on the right. So Oladejo Anige, you know, had the highest score, the perfect score, by the way, 10 over 10. And you have 9. Suwadu Bugoma, a great statistician, had 9. Adewusi Soter, Undiho Kubwayo scored a 9. And David also scored a 9. So that's quite impressive. We have for AC 812912, Trends in STEM Education. All of these people, interesting enough, all of them scored 19. Agbanimu, Ebinsin, Bile, Oladejo, and Peter. For AC 814914, that's entrepreneurship. These are the scores. Everybody here scored a 10. These are top scorers. And for the Burundi group, we have this. The top three for the Burundi group is David from DRC, 37, leading the pack. Jafet is number 2 with 31. Afiak Muyipundo scored 31. This is very, very good. Very good performance. For Nigerian group, the top three are Oladejo, Agbanimu, Gbeleyi, and Onowubeda. So let's look at the overall performance. That's the grand score. Yeah, so we have overall, these are the results. So 49 over 50, that's Oladejo. Oladejo is very consistent in scoring very high like this, also coming first. And then you have all of these people, Onowubeda, Agbanimu, Gbeleyi, second. And it goes on like this. You have all done very well, very, very well. There are some with blanks, which you can see here. These are the people who probably did not register for the course, and which is not bad at all. So the overall average is 30.67. That is not bad at all. I would like to congratulate you all for your impressive performance. Yeah, so having listened to a performance, which I said, which you can see, is brilliant for week 10, we now want to welcome our facilitator for today, Dr. Emmanuel Femi Jayola. So who is he? He holds a doctorate degree in cultural studies and social thoughts in education, and a graduate certificate in applied educational research methods, both from Washington State University. He has a master's degree in human resource development, international development, with specialty in gender studies. So he should be a friend of Professor Oche Nanzewi from the University of Manchester, United Kingdom. He conducts qualitative research in gender inequality and patriarchy in Africa, women empowerment, women participation, African feminism, and post-colonialism. He currently teaches 1 minute. Let me admit this paper. At Washington State University, Pullman, at the College of Undergraduate Studies. My pleasure to now invite Dr. Emmanuel Femi Jayola to present this two-part lecture on conducting qualitative research. So we'll go on now for 40 minutes, after which we will take questions and answers, and then we'll go on to the second leg. So over to you, Dr. Femi Emmanuel Femi Jayola.
Sir, I am highly privileged, I am honored to be here this morning, and thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to be sharing this lecture with the Africa's best doctoral students.
Yes, you got it. And that's correct.
Yeah. And also to the distinguished, eminent, respected, and esteemed faculty members that have been conducting all these lectures all the while. I'm particularly very excited to see my former boss and see my boss.
Yeah, of course. I wanted to tell you, Professor Ramon is still your boss forever. That is your boss.
Yes. Forever.
Yeah.
Once a boss is ever a boss.
Oh, yes, of course.
And I'm very, very, very...
Not Moldo, a boss. Not Moldo, a boss. Not Jaleku, a boss. But, I'm just joking. Go on.
That is coming to attend this lecture. I'm so happy when I saw his name. That's going to be a facilitator. He has been a lot of encouragement to me on this academic journey. I worked with him. Just everything that you have said, sir, is exactly what he is. And he really, really imputed that in me. And I'm really grateful to him. God bless you, sir. And I'm happy that I've been part of this program.
Yeah, sorry, Dr. Femi, can you, because your screen is just blinking, can you move on to something that we will see?
Yes, sir. Blinking. That's part of it, sir.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Go ahead.
So I'm going ahead to talk about something very, very, that's very key to this presentation. And this is an ark. And if you recall this at the Antediluvian in the Bible, God sought for a man and found him, and that man was Noah. Noah building that ark, and the ark is to save the people of the world, to solve their contextual problem at that time. So also, at this time, God is a sought for a man and found him to build an ark that is called CTCA. Yes, to solve the contextual problem in Africa. And that man is called Distinguished Professor Peter Okebukola.
Wonderful.
And God has really helped him to put all this together under the Center, Africa Center of Excellence for Innovative and Transformative STEM Education. And looking at the key thing about it is the cultural, techno-contextual approach to STEM education and research. This is to move on into studying or going to solve the problem of Africa.
Sure.
In the contextual, looking at the context of Africa's problem, sure. Not in the Western context.
Correct.
And I'm so grateful that God has blessed this generation, like many people have always said, to have distinguished Professor Okebukola to be a blessing to Africa.
I'm blushing already.
Yes. You need to do that. We give roses to people not only when they die, but when they are alive. You deserve this, more than this. This is what God is looking at for us in Africa. So we can sail through all the problems we have here. And we need to understand the African problem in the context of Africa. So we can be able to drive the vehicle of STEM education in the right direction so our problem can be things of the past. So today, in this lecture, we're going to be talking about the what, the why, the why and how of the qualitative research STEM in Africa. So, with special permission from you, sir, I would like the students to unmute themselves if they want to talk to me about this.
Okay. Approved.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah. So anybody can unmute themselves. You just tell me, what would you say about this, the relationship between these two images you have seen before you, the man and these two?
Fetigo, sir.
Yes, go on. Who is speaking? I think somebody is
Alanejo, sir.
Yeah.
It looks okay, sir. The two images looks like two parallel lines that can never meet.
Okay. Why did you say that, sir?
Looking at a man dressed in this attire, he looks like a medical doctor or a medical personnel. And this is a hand tool that is meant for a man that should be putting on where he can do hands-on activities.
So thank you very much. I love the way you have
Ramadan.
Hello?
Yeah, Ramadan. Ramadan.
Okay.
Go ahead, Ramadan.
I think this tools and doctor, I think they are similar. Doctor can use this tool for saving lives or repair something.
I would not like to see a doctor with this kind of sword to sort away the bone and hammer and drill. I would not like to see that doctor.
Yeah.
Ramadan.
They use this kind of tools.
By the way, Dr. Femi, Ramadan is in Senegal as he speaks. He's in Senegal. So what is telling us that the doctors, some doctors in Senegal, they use hammer to hammer the skull of people.
Okay, thank you so much. Thanks for the two contributions. And we can still draw our lessons from those two. And this is exactly why I'll come back to this, but I'd like to tell you that this is exactly one of the things I've learned from my daddy. You know, Professor Kebukola is my dad. Many people can say they are his mentor, their teacher, is their employer, is whatever. But he is my own daddy. And you know what the daddy is, either spiritual, academically, physical, or financial. Is everything that I am today.
I have no money again, no. Tell me, Dr. Bell, I have no money again, no financial. I'm joking. Yeah, please go on.
Thank you, sir. God bless you. So, back to Mr. Kunala Dejo. Let me take the contribution of the last person. Mr. Oladejo, you said this, that there are two parallel lines that cannot meet. Exactly. This is what Daddy always tells us, that you see, when we look at the theories, the concept, and these findings of Western researchers, they are very incongruent to the development of Africa.
Correct.
And also, and you see, this is maybe it's a colonial thing that have run through our brain, and that is why we see that there's a correlation of something between this man and this tool. That, oh yeah, this tool and this man, they look alike, or there's something that is similar. Never, never. That is why the Igbo theory or the Igbo formula, they just come back to Africa and try to do something for us. We will think that is the best. I tell you, we are not going to, we are all going to disembark from their act. and join the CTCA and move on straight and develop Africa. And if you want to do that, this is our own drone for STEM in Africa, developed into our own culture and context, so we can make things to happen in school, in the industries, and in the society. So if we want to do that, then we need to know what, you know, qualitative research is all about knowing the meaning in the context, you know, getting the context of the problem, and we'll be able to interpret it in the way it should be. So we want to look at some basic things about qualitative research. What is qualitative research? Why do we conduct qualitative research? When and how? And this is the overview of what we're going to do today. We see all this, and then we see how we're going to cover this in the first lecture. So I ask, what is qualitative research? A mode of inquiry mostly used in fields of study that deals with human activity. So I want you to begin to note that, human activities. Then it focuses on understanding social issues from the participants' perspective as they make meaning of their lives. So it's about the participant. It describes and uncovers meaning, questions, assumptions, and interprets a social phenomenon that is being studied. And with the focus on the contextual meaning of the phenomenon. So we see the relevance of this place to the center of art excellence. We see that we're talking about the context and culture. So philosophy of qualitative research, it is interpreting. That means it describes, explains, defines, to convey meaning. It's humanistic, and it's also naturalistic. That means also it places significant importance on the subject. The ontological assumption is that there is no single reality, but encompasses multiple realities for any phenomenon.
Correct.
What is the qualitative research paradigm? And I would like again, sir, if you allow some students to talk to us about this, describe this elephant in their own meaning, the way they see it. Yes, what can you say about this elephant? It's common in some part of Africa. How would you describe this elephant? Yep.
Adebayo Mohammed.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I would say we can actually say it's more like Africa, comparing with Africa, as a giant, that
giant.
Wherever Thank it you. Is, you will know. It will be note. You will notice that it's there.
Thank you very much. So, for sake of time, I just want maybe one word description. One word description. I will take giant from your description. Yes. Any other person?
Yes, Bella, is that?
Yes, sir.
The elephant here is in its natural habitat.
Natural habitat, thank you. Yes, one more.
Francis, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir.
It is frightening, sir.
It is what?
Frightening. You are afraid of it.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
So this is some of the things that came to my mind as well. It's huge. The big feet. Big ears, long nose, tusks, massive body, and plus other ones that you have mentioned. But I want to tell you a story here. There are six blind men that live in the community. The blind men, they can't see the elephant like you and I have seen it. And they want to know. They've been talking about elephant. Then one day, one man took them to where elephants are. Then because they could not see, they had to touch the elephant at different spots. Then after then, they said, talking about it. Everyone started talking about what an elephant is. Listen to their outcome. So the first person said, oh, the elephant is like a worm because he touched the body of the elephant. Then another one said, oh, it's like a spear because it touched the top. Another one said, oh, it is a magic carpet because this guy is touching the air. The other one said, oh, it's like a tree because he touched the net. And the other one said, rope because he was touching the tail. While the other one said, no, you don't know elephant at all. It's a big snake. That's why. Then I want to ask, let's all judge this. Six blind men, because we can see who is right. Yes, who is right?
They are all right.
All of them.
All of them are right.
Yes, of course. Good.
That's one of the quality, that's one of the paradigm of qualitative research. It has multiple realities. Nobody is wrong, but because of different perspectives, they have the same phenomenon. So that means there's no single fixed reality. And I put this, we experience and see things not as they are, but as we are.
Sure.
It is the way everyone interprets the world. No single or fixed reality. So moving forward, we focus on constructs. And a construct is the abstract idea underlying theme or subject matter that one wishes to measure. We'll talk more about this, God willing, in our workshop coming up on Saturday. So what is qualitative research? The nature of qualitative research includes the approach is inductive. That means there is a new theory that will be imagined from the data that you have collected and analyzed. The goal of qualitative research is to gain an in-depth, holistic perspective of people, context, events, phenomena. So if we have to solve African problems, we need to have the in-depth understanding and perspective of the people, of the context. And that is why when somebody conducts our own research for us from anywhere and interprets their own way, they cannot give us the right solution. As the importance and the significance of this CTCA drive to solve in STEM education to take us to develop the developed world. Yeah, setting, it is natural. You don't conduct qualitative research in the lab. Sampling is purposive, and data collection techniques include in-depth interview, focus group discussion, observation, documents, collection, and artifacts. We'll talk more about this as we go on in our lecture. Right. So data analysis is a true reduction process, a type of qualitative research design. One, grounded theory. Two, case studies. Three, phenomenology, ethnography, narrative. So, why do we conduct qualitative research? We conduct qualitative research to understand the underlying reasons for people's behaviors or uncover the meaning they give to some social context. So, when you just see somebody doing something, you need to know, why is he doing this? Why do you do what you are doing? That's one of the reasons why qualitative researchers go into the field to actually interact with the participants, to know the way they interpret or understand what is going on with them or in their society. To understand phenomena in the society from the perspective and experience of the participant. So let's take note of this, understand. Those are the very powerful keywords and the reason why we conduct qualitative research, to understand, to uncover the meaning, and to know and understand phenomena in the society. Also, the perspective and experiences are of great importance to a qualitative researcher. Right. What and who to study when we are conducting qualitative research? What? We are conducting a phenomenon. To know what a phenomenon is, it could be, for example, we talk about racism or tribalism or religious crisis or maybe gender inequality or things that happen in society. You want to know why are those things there? What's the understanding of the people? Why are they doing what they are doing? Then you can also find out something about the artifacts. The artifacts that has been could give us information about what it is and what is going to happen. Right. Phenomena can be cultures like I listed here, class, education, concept, women's rights, online learning as we're doing, and so many things. And artifacts could be picture or products connected to cultural meaning. So, who to study? Could be individual, could be families, could be a group, in any situation. So when do we conduct qualitative research? To get a deeper understanding of context, phenomena, cultural status of social work, and in view of providing a solution. This is so important. That's why a researcher is out there. You want to see how you can solve the problem. How do we conduct qualitative research? We identify the research problem. We review the literature. You need to know the literature very well. Read about it. Know what the problem statements and significance of the research. You write them out. You state your research questions, and you follow the research procedure. You develop the protocols for data collection, such as in-depth interview, focus group discussion, and observations and document collection. Then you do this ethical consideration and the approval. In the U.S. here, before you go out to do your research or the field, whatever, you need to go through the institutional review board. They will approve your research and the research procedure, the participants, and give you an approval. If you don't get an approval, you cannot go into the field. And this is so important because of the risk that goes with conducting this research with participants. So some guides to identify the research problem. Like I said, you have to know your literature. What are the contemporary or current debates that is going on the field or the area that you are interested in researching? You have to set the problem or issue to examine. You identify the gap in the existing studies and that you want to cover. Then you get a theoretical framework to put the study in perspective. So I give an example of a research problem from a research that has just been conducted. So I like us to, following what we have just stated, we'll see that knowing your literature, let's look at that on this example. You see, this research problem says, few studies on women grassroots empowerment in Nigeria. So it shows that this person has reviewed the literature, gone through it, and knows it, and says copious academic works have discussed the efficacy of these programs for women's economic development. That means it's talking about the contemporary or current debate going on in the literature around that subject. Then stating the problem or issue to examine. It says the gap, this research intends to address the gap. It's already saying that gap. So, and we also get a research theoretical framework to put the study in perspective. So, he focuses about research question. One, it must be broad and general. Two, it must seek participant experience. And research questions should be open-ended, should be non-directional, that is, must start with terms like how or what. It should be followed, start with broadest possible questions and then followed with some questions that narrow your focus. So I will give an example of, or two examples of research questions. What are the understandings and experiences of participants of grassroots empowerment programs in southwestern Nigeria? This is an example of qualitative research question. And also, how do students react to violence on campus? Why at this question like this? It will promote conversation. And through this, because it's not a yes or no answer, you don't ask such questions in qualitative research question. It's not a survey. It goes into discussion and conversation with the participant. And they can say a lot of things. And from there, you have a lot of data that you can extract.
Sure.
And also, you can follow up with clarifying questions that can go down deep to the experience and perspective and understanding of these participants. So research procedure. You need to identify appropriate design, knowing that you have the question now, you have your idea, you have the theoretical framework. You need to know what design that will be appropriate for your question, for your research. Then develop interview protocols about this. In qualitative research, you don't deal with questionnaire. You do interview protocols, like some guide question that will be guiding your conversation, discussion throughout the time you are interviewing participants. So you identify your participants, that is important as well. You have to know, because we said purposive, you need to know who those participants will be because of your subject. You want to talk about online education in Nigeria or in Burundi or in Ghana. You don't go to the marketplace and begin to talk, or you don't stay at the bus stop or at the airport and say, the first five people that I see, I'm going to talk to them. That is not it. You need to go right to where this is done. You have to know it. So it's so purposive, you must know it. And even with that, you must seek their opinion. You must talk to them. You must check with them if they want to do this. And know. When we get the workshop, we'll talk about some of the things that we need to do along this line. So you have to get the consent of the participant that I said and obtain research ethical approval. You have to have your logistics and recording gadgets, because you need to record their voices. You need to get, maybe sometimes you might need to take some pictures or video depending on the consent or approval you have. And having done all this, and what else do you need to do? You are ready to go for your data collection.
10 more minutes.
Yes, this is the last.
Okay.
This is the last slide.
Very good.
So, ready to go for your research data collection. And that is when we are going to come back in the next session.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much. We thoroughly enjoyed this part one of conducting qualitative research. The exposition has been by one and only Dr. Emmanuel Femi Jayola. You may wish to stop sharing your screen now, because yes, we now want to invite the students and others who want to ask you a few questions. From my side, Dr. Femi, I can see that your stay in the U.S. has given you, you can see that the ES is not enough. Your stay in the U.S. has significantly transformed you. You know, you are now a powerful researcher. You are now somebody who, you are a big man now in this business. But you know, when you started, you talked about the Western people and Africa and all that. And I appreciate your position. In our meeting yesterday, Professor Ramon Yusuf, students maybe want to listen to this. In our meeting yesterday, our daddy, Professor Olabi, is also here, the Deputy Center Director. Who watches this thing? Who watches Farid Zakaria? Do you watch Farid, Professor Ramon?
CNN.
Yeah, on Sundays, Farid. What happened was that Farid, I was just still working, you know, like all manner of back-end operations. I then had meta-analysis. As soon as I had meta-analysis, I just tuned to my television. I just switched my... And the person was saying that, he's a professor of medicine from Harvard. He said that a recent meta-analysis on race relations in the U.S. I told Professor Adichokwe this morning, I phoned him this morning, you know, and I shared this experience with him, that in the U.S., this recent meta-analysis, that the Oyibo man just discounted any article written by any black scholar, included only the ones by the whites, cited only the ones by the whites. And I was so unhappy listening to that. But I know that's true. I know that's true because Professor Ramon Yusuf is a global person in quality assurance and in ICT, education and ICT, and also in veterinary medicine. If an Yoruba man is writing an article related to the work that he has done, the Yoruba man would prefer to go and cite one undergraduate white person that cite him. So, I really love the way you're talking about the white man is not ready to solve our problems. It is we that will have to solve our problems. I like the analogy of the ark. So, very well done. And I'm so delighted that you are giving us this training. I want to beg of you, Dr. Femi, that after this, the workshop on Saturday, we will still ask you to take some one or two other lessons or practical classes, because a lot of our researchers in Nigeria have some deficiencies in the qualitative. They are good in quantitative, but the qualitative, we have some little challenge there. So I want to beg of you, after, today you are giving the second lecture, and then on Saturday you are giving the workshop. So the floor is open. If you want to take the floor, please just announce your name. Professor Olabi. Yes, who is next?
Francois.
Yes. Franklin. Okay, let's talk with that. Franklin, take the floor. First of all, let me mute everybody.
Yes, sir.
Hold on, let me mute everybody because there's some noise from some background there. Have you responded to my poll? I sent a poll. Have you responded to it?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay, let me end the poll now. Yeah, let me tell you where how to do the polling. Because I spoke with Professor Adichokwe this morning, and he said, I'm going to quote him. He said, citation is academic power. Your citation is academic power. So many of you are not uploading your papers, either seminar papers or project reports or whatever, on either academia or ResearchGate or Google Scholar. So I'm going to send to you links where today, by the end of this week, all of you in this class, all of you should have presence in any of these three platforms. So, Franklin, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I just want to know how qualitative research design comes to play when carrying out a mixed study of using qualitative and qualitative method of data collection, sir.
All right. Thank you very much. Kayode, I'll take you. Mr. Olariwaju, I'll take you. By the way, what I try to do, the Deputy Executive Secretary, sir, Professor Ramon Yusuf, I know I've muted you, but maybe you want to unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
What I try to do is, because out there, people will say Nigerian universities, you don't do anything, you are not. So I try to invite the press. So the press is here. And that's Kayode, it works for Daily Telegram. I have a Tribune too, you know, and a few others. So for them to see what we are doing, that is not, we are not just folding our arms and drinking tea and just relaxing.
So that's very important.
Oh, yeah. They have been carrying us.
Very important.
Yeah, practically. So it's not a question.
So that we do not continue to wink in the dark.
Exactly. Thank you, sir. Francois, you have the floor. Francois, you have the floor. You may wish to unmute yourself.
Okay, thank you, sir. First of all, I want to congratulate Professor Emmanuel for his presentation, brilliant presentation. But I have one question. In terms of method, I want to know if all aspects which has been developed have to be observed in the same manner. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so very much, Dr. Francois. We'll take on Fred from Ghana.
I didn't get a question.
Dr. Femi, we'll get back to you. In a minute. So we'll get back to Francois and we'll ask his question, our question again. Yeah.
Okay.
Fred, take the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Prof. I think I might have to do with the ethical considerations. See, he, in the presentation, he said that in the United States of America, before you go to the field, a letter is properly written to indicate that you can go to the field and all of that. In our part of the world, it is done too. But I just think that what is making our issues not go too far is the issues of fraud in academia, and it is linked to the ethical considerations. People sometimes do not adhere to lay down rules of doing research. How do we overcome it? That's my best thing.
All right. I will take on our daddy, Professor Tunde Wolabi, the Deputy Central Director. And then I'll come back to Francois. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, sir.
Let me start by congratulating Professor Femi Jayola for a lecture well delivered. As earlier observed by distinguished Professor Peter Ibukola, most academics, most scholars in Africa have pseudo understanding of qualitative research studies. So on this note, I want you, sir, to help us shed light on two critical aspects of methodology. Because the pseudo understanding is as a result of poor conception of methodology of qualitative study. So all these design you have mentioned, branded theory, case study, phenomenology, ethnography, there's need for us to have more information
Yeah.
About 10.
Sure.
And also, the method of analysis of data in qualitative studies, there is need for our students to have better grip and understanding of how to analyze data in qualitative studies. Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you so very much, our Deputy Center Director. I'm sure you all will be happy to note that the way this course is designed is you give some kind of little theory and then practicals. On Saturday, for 2 hours, all he's doing is analysis. On Saturday. Is that not true, Femi? On Saturday, all he's doing is, practicals. That's the workshop. So, we have a workshop on Saturday this one is just like the preliminaries. I think, according to the program, this first lecture is surface, theory, and then the second lecture will dig in deeper in the theory. Then on Saturday, he will have to teach us a lot about the... I can see you are warming up for Senate, Professor Wolabi. You are looking at the time.
Exactly.
I can see. Don't yes, worry. No, that's why I've pleaded with him. The Saturday workshop may not even be enough workshop for the practical part of it. So that's why I pleaded with him that he may have to come back so we have greater grounding. Francois, you have the floor again. The professor didn't hear you properly.
Okay. Thank you, sir, again. I said that in terms of mixed method, and this aspect developed in his presentation have to be observed in the same manner. Because I saw some students begin by conducting first qualitative research and after quantitative research, or vice versa. All aspects developed in his presentation have to be observed in the same manner. Thank you, sir.
All right. That's fine. Thank you very much. Dr. Femi, I hope you get the gist of what you said. So you may need to respond very briefly in about 7 minutes to the questions and observations. Over to you.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate your first comments, and I'm willing to always offer myself for service anytime you call on me, sir.
Wonderful.
I'll be very happy to do that. The question about mixed method, I don't know who somebody talked about that. By the grace of God, I think he's still on the program. At this time, maybe next week, we're going to talk about mixed method. That's on the program, sir. I'm sure he's still
there. Yeah, correct, yeah. Still there.
So we might not need to talk more about that now, because that first question, that one will be answered during that time. Second one is ethical condition. Yeah, consideration. I didn't conduct any, I didn't go through any research approval in Nigeria before I came down here. So I do not know what's the situation there. But here, last year I was in Nigeria to conduct a qualitative research. Before I left here, I had to pass all my documents, the description of my participants, even my protocol, through Institutional Review Board, that will go through it and see that everything about each person I'm going to do is approved, is safe for my participants. It's all about participants. But you know, Africa, and I'm sure that's one of those things that this center is set out to do.
Sure.
The cream of the academia that I've met here makes me to tremble and shake. Yes. And bringing them here, I know we are up to serious business.
Absolutely.
About doing something very qualitative and standard in Africa as we go on. So I'm happy that the first comment that he made when he talked about being a qualitative, you know, I'm not talking about this research method now, qualitative scholar, researcher.
Exactly.
And he made a reference to my boss, Professor Dr. Suleiman Ramon. is a very diligent and detailed person. I remember those times when we write email or write letter. If you fail to dot and hide, it will draw your memo out.
Yes.
And that's the kind of training that we are living up to. That's the way to destroy corruption in Nigeria,
sure,
or in Africa. And go, if few, we can't say because everybody is doing it, then we have to do that. We have to distinguish ourselves and be a light. Then if you and I become to do, we start doing what is right.
Yeah.
You see, the whole environment will be lightened up.
That's correct.
So my suggestion, I don't know, I'm sure the way, the vision I am seeing that I can keen in into what distinguished Professor Peter Okebukola is doing, is that we're still going to get back to where there's going to be a standard approval for research, like a gatekeeper. Yeah. That's what he established in NUC, when I worked with him in NUC. Qualitative, quality assurance. Institutional ranking, institutional accreditation, program accreditation, they were firm. So I'm sure we'll get there. I don't know what it happens, but this is what we're going to do. Even with the comment that he made, and that's very true, it's very disheartening. When researchers, if you imagine, talking about grandpa in the bricks, in academics, in medical field, and it's not well celebrated in the Western world here. You see, sometimes it makes me to shed tears that we cannot put our lamp under the bushel. We need to blow our trumpet in Africa. And that is exactly where we are now. So, going again to the... Yeah, I think Daddy has answered Professor Tunde Wolabi. By the grace of God, we'll do a lot. In the second lecture, we're going to go a little deeper into data analysis. Then I'm there. And for... I think I've answered the question.
Oh, yes, you have. Yes, sir. That's quite good. Quite impressive. I'd like to thank you again. And we will want to bring this first session to a close. I would like to ask Professor Ramon Yusuf whether he can stay with us till about 12 noon when we present a plaque to Femi. But if he's not going to stay till 12 noon, we can ask him to make the presentation on our behalf now.
I'll be here, sir.
Oh, they were wonderful, wonderful. So let us bring this session to a close. I will take a few minutes, like 30 minutes of break. Let's clap for Professor Femi Jayola for a job. Very well done. Yes.